So let's see. Let me just quickly review what I did last time. So what I'm interested in is that toric varieties seem to appear surprisingly often. And I'm not sure I have a complete answer for that, or much of an answer at all, but have some of an answer for that. So recall the general setup. So if you XD is a toric pair, then but we know a bunch of things. We know that KX plus D is equivalent to zero. So D is the sum of the invariant divisors. We know that XD is log canonical. And then the other thing we know is that the number of components of D, let's say that's n plus sigma, which is dimension of X, plus the dimension of this space of A divisors, modulo numerical equivalence. So in general then, the idea is to define if X is a log pair, and you introduce two numbers, the complexity, which I call C, so that's D minus N minus R, so that's the sum of the coefficients minus the dimension minus dimension space. So the complexity, you take the sum of the coefficients. So if they've all got coefficient 1, that's just the number of components, the dimension of X, there's not much to explain there. And then you look at the space spanned by the components. So for a toric variety, the components span the space of all the Vey divisors. And then slightly different invariant absolute complexity, almost exactly the same, call it gamma, D minus N minus sigma. So then the only thing you need to know is that sigma is this thing here. So this is sigma. Okay, let's see. So then the theorem I wanted to talk about, this is with Brown, myself, Spalding, Song. So X delta log canonical pair. X is proper. So if minus KX plus delta is NF, then let's see, C is greater than or equal to 0. 2, if C is less than 1, that implies X is toric. And then let's see, D. Oh, I didn't say this last time, but you can even assume that the any invariant divisor, you can even choose the invariant divisor so that any invariant divisor is bigger than any component of coefficient 1. and then all but round down to 2C components of D are components of delta. So if C is less than a half, every component of D is a component of delta. And then finally, if gamma is less than 3/3, then X is rational. So, by the way, it's pretty obvious that what? I beg your pardon? Oh, I always do that. Yes. Yes. Okay, there you go. I always get it wrong. There you go. Yeah, it's my definition and I get it wrong. Thanks. Yeah, so okay, that's better. That's right, good. That's what was confusing me. So obviously then gamma is less than C. C is less than gamma, obviously, because obviously a subspace is dimension less than the actual space. There you go. So this is a stronger condition than requiring C is less than 1. C is less than 3/2. Oh, yeah. So I guess that's where I was last time. I gave you a couple of examples to show this is sharp. Let me give you one more interesting example. And that's to see that the log canonical condition is important. So it's really important you have log canonical condition. It's not a hard example. Take X to be Fn. That's a P1 bundle over P1. P1 bundle. So take it so, I mean, the N means that there's something of self-intersection minus N. In other words, this is the projectivization of O plus O of N. So you can see that minus KFN, well, it is a toric variety, right? So this is equivalent to E0 plus E infinity plus 2 fibers. But you see, this is equivalent, I mean, this is equivalent to 2E infinity plus E0 is equivalent to E infinity plus N fibers. So this is equivalent to F0 plus F1 plus ... Fn plus 1. So the pair Fn, 2E infinity, F0 plus Fn plus 1. So of course, then the sum is linear equivalent to 0. And what's the complexity of this? So C is equal to, well, 2. 2 for the Picard number. So 2 for the dimension, 2 for the Picard number. But then D is huge. D is 2 plus n plus 2. So 2 plus n plus 2. So what's that? Something. Yeah, I mean, so this is small. as n goes to infinity, you can see it goes to minus infinity. So it's very important that you don't allow anything coefficient bigger than 1, because if you do, you can't say anything about the complexity. It can be as small as you like. And then the other thing to say is, well, you might say, well, it's not really log. I mean, the key thing is coefficient less than 1. I mean, less than or equal to 1. But you see, you can always contract E infinity. It's a cone, right? and then you get n plus 2 fibers. So you can look at Fn bar and then F0 prime, the images, and then again, this has got very small complexity. So, but of course, it's still a boundary. It's still got curve. You can get rid of the coefficient 2 by contracting it. So the point, but again, the point is that this is not log canonical because of this 2. This is a resolution, and the 2 says it's not log canonical. Okay. Any questions about any of that? So it might seem fanciful to have this log canonical condition, but it's actually very, very important. So yeah. Not log canonical because of this. Okay, let's see. So let me try and indicate how you prove this theorem. So it's quite interesting. I mean, there's something very tempting to do that really doesn't work very well. And it's very tempting to try and prove this theorem by running the minimal model program. Try to contract divisors. If you contract divisors, if you run MMP, flips you don't care about. It turns out that if two varieties are isomorphic in codimension 1 and one is toric, then the other is toric. That's easy to see. So you don't care about flips. And contracting divisors is very much in your favor because the Picard number drops. And with some argument, you can show that you have to think about it, but if after the contraction the variety is toric, then the original guy is toric, and you run MMP and you get down to Mori fiber space, but then that's when the headache starts. It's really not so obvious how to deal with a Mori fiber space, but there is one case where you can deal with it. So let me just explain that. And the point is to think about this example, this special case, in a very differently. Okay, so there's a special case. So if you run MMP, for example, one possible out case, if you run MMP, first of all, you can assume that X is Q factorial projective. Oh, I just wanted to say one other thing as well. It might seem kind of fanciful to say proper rather than projective. But let me just point out one thing. Most toric varieties, if they're proper, they're not necessarily projective, right? There are examples of toric varieties which are proper but not projective. And if you think about it a second, what that really says is that most toric varieties are not projective. So in fact, actually, to say it's quite restrictive to say projective, because then you're missing most interesting examples of toric varieties. I mean, there are lots of toric varieties with no interesting NEF divisors and all sorts of weird behavior. Okay, so yeah, so but if you pass a DLT modification or something like that, you can assume that X is projective, Q factorial. And then if you run MMP, you get down, maybe, if you're very lucky, you get down to Picard number 1, not just an arbitrary Mori fiber space. So this is a special case. And I'll give you an argument for this special case. So this is in flips and abundance. So what that means, I guess, is it's about 25 years old. Cool, that's a scary thought. Yeah, so somehow, I mean, even if we do this special case, there's still a lot of work. Okay, but anyway, if you assume the Picard number is 1, then you can then some common multiple of the components of delta and of minus kx is a very ample divisor H. Right, if you have pick on number one, everything spans the same ray, and if it's positive, it's all of them, you know, point in the same direction. So some positive multiple will be a very ample divisor. Okay. So you embed X in projective space using this very ample divisor. And then what you do is you take, you let Z be the cone over X. Okay, so I guess what the picture is X sitting inside projective space. And you just take the cone over it, and you get Z. So Z sits, of course, inside An plus 1. And now you let theta be the cone over delta. So just the obvious thing, if you're given a bunch of divisors in X, and you take their cone, and then you just give them the same the coefficients, right? So the obvious thing. But here's the key point. So the key point the components Ti of theta are Q Cartier. Right? Since a multiple di or a multiple of di is h. So you see, h is defined by a linear equation. So it's the cone over h is defined by the same linear equation. So it's Cartier. So that means that the multiple of ti is the, you know, given by this the obvious defining equation of h when you take the cone over h. Another sort of way to see that this is so special, if you take something that's not Picard number one, you get a classic example of something that's not Q factorial. You know, if you take P1 cross P1, take its standard embedding, and you take the cone over that, that'll give you the classic example. This is not Q factorial. So this is P1 cross P1. And the way to see it's not Q factorial is that the take a cone, I mean, what do? You take the cone over either line that gives you two planes that intersect at a point. So Cartier divisors would intersect along a curve. So yeah, the cone over something of higher Picard number, you'll get divisors which are not Q Cartier. But if you have Picard number one and you take the cone, you'll get Q Cartier divisors. So that's very important to this argument. So that's why Picard number one is so important. Okay. Okay, so note that. The other thing to realize is that Z theta is a log canonical pair. I mean, for the same reason, K of Z is Q Cartier as well. I guess K of Z is Q Cartier. So kz plus theta is R Cartier, it would be Q Cartesian unless the coefficients of theta are real. And yet you see what you can do. It's a cone, so if you blow up the vertex, you get something, let's call it Y, which is then a P1 bundle. Actually, an A1 bundle, right? A1 bundle over X. And then there's an exceptional divisor. But then the exceptional divisor is isomorphic to X. It's a section. So I guess pictorially, you've got a cone. Blow it up, you get a bundle mapping to the base with an exceptional divisor E, and then that guy is an isomorphism. And so that tells you that Z theta is Lacanical. So let's say this map is pi. And then it's very easy to see that ky plus theta tilde, the strict transform, plus e, you can check that this is nothing more than pi x, sorry, z plus theta. So that's true. So you can check. So that tells you that e has log discrepancy 0. So now you just have to show this is log canonical. So kz plus theta is log canonical if and only if y theta tilde plus e is log canonical. So two ways to see this is log canonical. Number one, you can do a junction. So ky plus theta tilde plus e restricted to e is k of x, sorry, is k of e plus some different. But then this is isomorphic. I mean, this is naturally, just basically the same as kx plus delta is log canonical. And now inversion of a junction. Is log canonical. That's number one. That's the complicated way of doing it. The other way of doing it is just resolution of x gives you a resolution of y. I mean, all you've got is an A1 bundle, right? So if you resolve x, you resolve y, and the log discrepancies are the same. It's easy to see that. So either way, you get something that's log canonical. Okay, so you start off with something, a Picard number one, you take the cone over it, you get something which is log canonical, and yet the point is that when you collapse, I mean, you see, here, what you see is that all the components of delta, when you pull them back, they become these vertical divisors. And then you contract them, they all pass through the vertex of the cone. I guess that's also obvious here, right? All the components of delta pass through the vertex of the cone. So you have a pair and a point on that pair where the sum of the coefficients is large. Okay, so let me observe that. So maybe make another definition. if you have a germ of a log pair, let's say z theta, let's say a point P, the local complexity is nothing more than the dimension of z minus d, the sum of the coefficients. Well, okay, let's call that m minus t, dimension of z minus the sum of the coefficients. So in the local, for the local complexity, you don't have to worry about any Picard number, right? It's just they're all passed through a single point. Okay, so then the key result is the following. In flips, this is all in flips and abundance, so it's very old. Z theta, germ of a log canonical pair. If every component of theta is Q-Cartier, that's very important, then the complexity is greater than or equal to zero, local complexity, and if C is less than one, then Z is toric, or toroid, or whatever you want to call it, and all but round down 2C components of theta are invariant divisors. So again, the point is that, you know, if you know that X is toric, and you take the cone, then obviously what you get, the cone over a toric variety is toric variety. So then you'd be able to see that you have, I mean, especially at this would be an invariant point. So you take the neighborhood of this, you have a toric variety. And then what this proposition is sort of is going backwards. If you know the complexity is small enough, then you must have a toric pair, and then we'll be able to deduce that X is toric. Let's see. Any questions about that? And of course, you see, let me point out that M for us is N plus 1, rho is equal to 1, sigma is equal to 1, and then the sum of the coefficients is the sum of the coefficients. So it's this C here is the same C as the C of X. So the proof of this proposition is, I mean, it's old, but it's very nice. So by induction on the dimension, so here's the key trick. So let W to Z be a composition of cyclic covers so that every component SI of theta tilde, that the pullback is Cartier. So you're given a bunch of Q-Cartier divisors, and it's just a local problem. Each one, some multiple, is Cartier, but as soon as it's Cartier locally, it's trivial. And so, you know, basic result in Colamori, basic result in this subject is that given some multiple of a Vey divisor, if it's trivial, some multiple of a line bundle, tensor product of a line bundle, if it's trivial, you get an associated cyclic cover. You take a composition, you step by step, you make all of these components Cartier, composition of cyclic covers. Okay, so then you make them all Cartier. Okay, so then let F be the defining equation. So Fi, rather, be the defining equation. Si, and of course Si is just the pullback of Ti. So it's a Cartier divisor, so it's local, so it's given by some equation. Okay, now let F sum Fi, Ci Fi be a general linear combination. So sort of general in the sense of Bertini. So these guys are complex numbers. Oh, let's see, I have to erase something, don't I? Because what I'm going to erase is this. Okay, so then let S be F equals 0. And now the point is that S specializes to Si, right? Because you take a general linear combination. So S is less singular than Si. So really what you do is you take a log resolution of W, and for that log resolution, if you take the CIA general enough, the multiplicity of any exceptional divisor for this log resolution is less than multiplicity for S is less than SI. So what that says, okay, so now pick numbers between AI and 0 such that, oh I see, sorry, I'm assuming that theta is some AI TI, so theta tilde, the pullback is some AI SI, so pick BI such that the sum of the BI is exactly equal to 1. Of course, we're assuming the complexity is small. We're assuming the complexity is small. We can assume it's less than 1 because we want to show it's either greater than 0, or if it's less than 1, we want to come to a conclusion. So we assume the complexity is less than 1, then the sum of the coefficients is large. So in particular, you can pick some numbers between 0 and A such that their sum is equal to 1. And then what's true is that Z, well, throw in T, but throw away the corresponding component of TR, not TS, not ZW. Okay, everything's wrong. Okay, there we go. This guy is Lacanian. As, of course, we're assuming that W sum AI SI is log canonical. So it's a Bertini sort of argument. S is less singular than the sum of the BI SI. So if you replace the sum of the BI SI by S, you get something that's log canonical. And then, easy check. S is normal. So the point is that W has KLT singularities, so that's Cohen-Macaulay. So S is certainly S2, and it's easy to check it's smooth in co-dimension one. So S is normal. So then you can do a junction. So KW plus S plus some AI minus BI SI restricted to S KS plus, I don't know, phi, and then sum of the coefficients of phi is at least the sum of the coefficients of theta minus 1. In other words, the local complexity of S phi is less than the local complexity of W theta tilde, which is then less than or equal to C, the local complexity of Z theta. Because when you take a cover, you could only get more components. When you do a junction, you might get more components. So there might be a different, you might get multiplicities. All sorts of things might make the sum of the coefficients of phi bigger than the sum of the coefficients. But doesn't matter. So that's good. That's in our favor. So then, finally, to erase something, let me erase this. So finally we can finish. So by induction, oh, I see. So, yeah. Okay, sorry. I'm missing the whole point. So claim W is smooth, and then proof by induction. So S is smooth by induction. Okay, so then S is a Cartier divisor. That implies that W is smooth. And now once W is smooth, you're very happy, because then multiplicity arguments tell you that lots of the SI will be smooth, and then they have to intersect transversely. So then you just argue that W is smooth, lots of components of S are smooth. So W is smooth, so W is isomorphic to CM or AM, that's a toric variety. And then these components, the coordinate hyperplanes are invariant divisors. So the point is, you know that components of S are smooth. You can argue they intersect transversely by induction. You can check that when you do a junction. If phi is simple normal crossings, then that's basically going to, or some subset of the divisors are phi normal crossings, that's going to imply that these guys are normal crossings. So then basically you know you have a toric variety, because you know explicitly you have AM, and you explicitly you have coordinate hyperplanes. And then to get back down to Z, you're taking a cyclic action, but then that cyclic action fixes the coordinate hyperplanes, and so that's telling you that the quotient is toric. So then, Z is AM, modulo a product of cyclic groups. So it's a toric variety. But the point is that those guys are fixing the coordinate hyperplane, so this is a toric variety. And then the images Ti of Si are invariant devices. So whatever invariant devices you had upstairs, you can check that you get them downstairs. And so then that proves the proposition. And then once you've got the proposition, let's see, so time. So then you go back and the original X, you took the cone, here, this is Z, so you can recover X number one, you can recover it by blowing up P. So that's good. It's a divisor of log discrepancy zero for a toric variety, the exception divisor, but that's an invariant divisor, so that's a toric variety. So then X is toric, blowing up, exception divisor has log discrepancy zero. That implies it's a toric variety. That implies X is toric, etc. Or you can just argue that X is Z modulo GM. It's a GIT quotient. And this is a toric variety acting by a torus. It commutes with the action of the torus of Z. So X is a toric variety. But either way, X is toric. Okay, so that's the argument in flips and abundance. If the Picard number is 1, you take the cone over X, you get something which is local. It has lots of divisors passing through a single point. That forces the vertex of the cone to be a toric variety, and then you can deduce that X had to have been toric. The only way you can get a cone which is a toric variety is if the cone is a toric variety, you must have had a toric variety to start with. Okay, so our goal is to repeat this argument, right? It's a nice argument, so let's make this argument work in higher dimensions. And the key thing will be this local result, z theta. So let me leave that on the board. Find an argument, find a generalization of this argument. Okay, so what we'll assume is something rather strong, and I'll explain this next time. We'll assume that minus kx plus delta is ample. So for the theorem I proved with Brown and Svaldi and Zong, I just assume it's nef. So assuming it's ample seems a lot stronger. It's a big difference between nef and ample. We'll assume that X is Q factorial. That's a small, small point. And we'll assume it's projective. That's easy by MMP. That's no big deal. And the other big assumption was we'll assume and that the components of delta span the group of Vedi vices. I mean the class group. Span the class group. An minus 1 modulo numerical equivalent. So we assume that this is finitely generated. Well, that's finitely generated because it's rationally connected. I mean, minus kicks is ample, so it's rationally connected. So it's got its class group is not too complicated. So I'll assume all these things. So next time, explain how to reduce in this case. Okay, but that'll be next time. So the basic idea is we want to mimic this cone construction, but it's kind of hard, right? You can't just take the cone over. So if you take cone over P1 cross P1, you won't get something that's Q factorial. So that's a mess. So what you want to do is use these ideas of Hu and Kiel, the idea of a Mori dream space. And then we'll use some results of Kawamata and Okawa. So use results Kawamata and Okawa, and actually I guess also Brown. Okay, so let A1 up to AR, or A row I suppose, be ample divisors. Whose images in the class group, well, with Q coefficients, tensor Q, generate the class group. I mean, it's surjective. There you go. Okay. So instead of doing the cone, I do something kind of similar. What you do is you look at a projective bundle. But it's going to be higher rank. So now we just look at the projective bundle given by the direct sum. So of course this sits over X. It's a PR minus 1 bundle, or P row minus 1 bundle. Oh, I see. Let me just point out that this implies that C is equal to gamma, right? Because if the components of delta span, then rho is equal to rho, R is equal to rho. And then the point is that, I mean, to cut a long story short, well, first of all, this is the construction of Kawamata Okawa. The point is that you can contract the negative. I mean, it's like the cone over. I mean, the case of an ordinary cone was when you've got basically one guy, right, or two guys, I suppose. You just got. Wait a minute. So now I'm confused. What am I taking? Actually, you know what? I'm not projectivizing. That's better. I beg your pardon. What I want to take is the total space. I raise his spec. That's what I want, right? There we go. I want the total space. This is a row minus 1 bundle. Thank you. I mean, that's exactly the same as what we had before. So then it will be a row bundle. There we go. It's exactly what you've got in the case of Picard number one. It's the sort of the natural generalization. And then the point is that you can contract the negative section, but that's not quite what we want to do. I mean, that will be log canonical, but we want to look at spec of the Cox ring. So we want to look at spec of the Cox ring of X. So let me recall what that is. So, I mean, there are various definitions of this. So let me use the definition of in Kawamata Okawa. So it will be basically the same thing, but you take all negative and positive multiples. So H0 X OX of M1 A1 plus M2 A2 M row. So this is a multi-graded ring. The key thing is that the Cox ring, you allow negative multiples. So of course, if you take all of them negative, you won't get any sections. But some, if you take some of them positive, some of them negative, you might get sections. You'll get things that I mean, not every effective divisor need be ample, right? So this is a multi-graded ring. I mean, essentially graded by this, but this is essentially, roughly speaking, it's a n minus one of x, right, up to torsion, and that's what the Cox ring is. And so this is what this is what corresponds to collapsing the exceptional divisor down to a point, and then. So what you do, take this picture. So you've got x delta, that gives you then a y gamma in an obvious way just by pulling back. And then you get a z theta. And again, the main result is that this guy is log canonical. OK. And then again, what's the local complexity? And the whole point is that this is basically a germ. So there's a single point P and Z, a special point, like a special point when you had the cone, and then every component of theta passes through P. And then you see the dimension of Z is the dimension of x plus rho, so that's m plus rho, and then the sum of the coefficients of theta is the sum of the coefficients of delta. That's obvious. So if the local complexity, sorry, if the complexity of x delta is small, then that's exactly the same as the complexity of z theta. So if this guy is less than zero, this guy is less than zero, et cetera, et cetera. But that's what this proposition says. It says, so immediately you get that, because of this proposition, you immediately get the complexity of this guy is greater than or equal to zero. And then if the complexity of this guy is less than one, the complexity of this guy is less than one, so this guy is toric. Okay. Very, very similar argument to the argument in flips and abundance, but you need to use a multi-graded ring. So the sort of this whole idea about using the Cox ring, it's very pretty. Okay, so the complexity of x delta is equal to the local complexity of z theta. So immediately we see that the, let me call this C. So C is greater than or equal to zero by proposition. What else do we know? We know if C is less than one, that implies that Z theta is toric. But in fact, you see, what we know is much more. We know that this is a quotient of An. So this Z is a quotient of An. So basically, what you know is that, yeah, so Z is a quotient of An. But observe one thing. And this is rather, this is the key observation of Hu and Kiel, is that there's a torus, a natural torus, acting on Y and on Z. It's GM to the rho. The action on Y is completely obvious. It's just an A rho bundle. So you just on each factor. I mean, it's a direct sum, right? So on each factor, you just act by GM, just like for a cone. And then that action on Y gives you an action on Z. I mean, actually, I guess the action on Z is pretty obvious because an action of a torus is given by a grading. This is obviously a multi-graded ring, so it has a natural action by GM to the rho, because the action of a torus is exactly the same as a multigrading. On the other hand, what is Y modulo? What is this geometric quotient? Well, it's obviously X, right? Because obviously, if you mod out by the torus, you just get X. Of course, you have to throw something away, as in ordinary GIT, you throw away the zero section. And then that just tells you that Z modulo a torus is X. But then Z is a quotient of An, of Am, I guess. M is n plus rho. So what that tells you is that if you think about it for a little bit, you can argue that in fact, so with a small argument, what you know is that X is a quotient of An by a torus. But then there's a theorem, essentially due to Cox and Kiel, let G as G and R act on An, then the quotient X. I mean, it has to respect. It's going to be a reasonable action. Then is a toric duality. And that's just really fairly standard representation theory. So, in the end, it's just a simple generalization of the argument in flips and abundance. It's just you should have thought of the cone as being a quotient of. I mean, a cone is naturally an A1 bundle with an actual action of GM, and then the quotient is X. So I thought it'd be nice just to give you a couple baby examples of this theorem, because it's kind of fun. End with something kind of fun. So just some baby examples. Because it's really pretty that this is. This idea is very pretty. So for example, the easiest example that everybody knows, if you've got AM to AM, you take g equals gm, and then the action is x1 up to xm goes to t x1 up to xm. So I guess in my multi-graded ring, everything has the same grading. And of course, the quotient is Pm minus 1, which is a toric variety, that's for sure. Another funny example is you take Gm cross Gm. So let's say you got A4 to A4. Let's say A, B, C, D. So there's an S and a T. So S, A, S, B, S, C, T, C, T, D. Then obviously on one factor you get P1, on the other factor you get P1. So the quotient is P1 cross P1. So that's how you get P1 cross P1, but the point is it's not a quotient by a single torus, right? Because the cone over P1 cross P1 is never factorial. So you need to take a product of two tori to get P1 cross P1. And then, of course, if you, for example, if you vary the weights, then instead of getting projective space, you'll get weighted projective space, etc. Okay, so next time I'll explain how to reduce the Kay-Sitz Fano. Okay.